Hi, this is Kelly from The Truth in Story, and today I'm going to do a bit of an unboxing, and this time I didn't put it in the title, so I could do my lead up that I love to do so much without it having been given away in the title. I had wanted to do this actually forward facing, but my iMac decided to die yesterday despite it being 2 months old. Lovely. And so it is at the Mac store being fixed. And unlike many people who have a great deal of patience in opening decks, even months later, I do not have that type of patience. And so, and my laptop really isn't capable of doing that. So I'm just going to go ahead and do it this way. We'll just work with what we have. So as you can see here, I have a pile of books because, you know, if you've watched many of my videos, you probably realize I am the great fan of the preface or the introduction or the lead up. And so I can't just go right into something. So this deck, the reason that I really wanted to do this deck as an unboxing, not later as a review, is because it's very rare for me to get a deck in which I really haven't seen the cards. I've seen a few of the cards. I think there is a video or two online of it, but I get quite motion sick, and if there is a video that is somebody hand holding it to, like, panning around, it literally makes me nauseous and I can't watch it. So I haven't actually, I've seen some key cards. There are images that you can Google, so I've seen them that way, but I haven't gotten to have like a good look through all of the cards like I usually do before I purchase a card deck. But this is rather a different deck for me, and I'm really not quite sure what I'm going to think about it, but I got it a good deal on it. And I was looking for a deck to get because I had gotten rid of, I'm trying not to buy decks for a little bit, but I had gotten rid of an Oracle deck, and so I allow myself to replace in that situation. But I really couldn't find one. Again, I have quite a few decks on my wish list, but currently what's on my wish list are either some that I'm waiting for to be published, or they're just more expensive decks that I'm not currently in the market to get yet. I need to do a wish list, like blog post or something, or even video of the decks that I do have on my wish list, and then see what everybody else's is. That would be fun. But anyways, so the decks that are on my wish list are kind of either out of my current range of purchasing of a deck, or I'm waiting for it to be, there's one that I'm really waiting for to be released. So I was kind of looking through, you know, different smaller decks or such, like less pricey decks. and I just really, I'm so picky with tarot decks. There's so many things that rule out a deck that I would want to really work with. And as you probably know, I do tend to get decks that I really am going to work with. I'm not one. At this moment, at this phase in my life, I'm not really getting decks just for collection. So they are decks that I really do want to work with. And so I just really wasn't seeing. And the other thing is that I'm also looking for decks that bring something different than what I have currently. So there are a lot of decks on my wish list that are less pricey, that I do eventually want to get, but they're quite similar in feel or style or whatever to things that I have now. And so because I'm being careful about my deck purchases, I really, if I get a deck, I want it to kind of be something different, bring something a little bit different to the table. So I was kind of getting a little bit frustrated. I'm thinking, here, I really actually want to buy a deck, but nothing's just, it just wasn't ticking any of my boxes. It really wasn't saying, oh yeah, that's it. And then I stumbled on one that I had never seen before. And it immediately, even though I couldn't find all the images that I wanted, even though it is quite different in style than anything that I have right now, I could not resist it because of this stack, two stacks of books that you'll see right here. I am a fantasy geek. I have been my whole life. My father used to read Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit to us when we were growing up. And I, of course, on the top, I had to have these two classics. This is one by J.R.R. Tolkien. It's not Lord of the Rings, although I do have that set. I would just literally just kind of grab some stuff off the shelf that were some of the older ones that got me into the fantasy genre. So this is J.R.R. Tolkien's Smith of Wootton Major and Farmer Giles of Ham. This is just two of his shorter stories. But, you know, if you're going to talk fantasy, you have to talk J.R.R. Tolkien. And I know it's also, I think it's correctly pronounced Tolkien. I'm just going with Tolkien because I grew up with that, so I know it's probably incorrect, and I didn't take the time to really look it up. However, here we have it. The other one, you know, if you're going to be talking fantasy, The King of Elfland's Daughter by Lord Dunsany is, you know, just classic. It's something that, it's a book that everybody who is a fan of fantasy should read because it is one of those beginning ones that are quite important. So I had those two up there first. And then these are just some random ones, just that Catherine Kerr has an entire series. This is one of the first, it's a very long, and this isn't even the actual, and there's more after this, but this isn't the very first one. I think the first one is Daggerspell. But these smell kind of funny, I'm gonna say. They're a little musty. They shouldn't be. Anyways, this whole series was one that I really got me into fantasy more as an adult. Dennis McKiernan, yes, again, this is not, I don't believe, the first one in the series. It's one of the first ones. It's possible. It's been a while since I've read these, but this might actually be the first one. But he has tons of different books. But this Dennis McKiernan, The Eye of the Hunter, again, this is that high fantasy, sort of the Tolkien style fantasy that you would think of. These are two, this series, Rhapsody by Elizabeth Hayden, is a series that I absolutely love. This is one of my all-time favorite fantasy books. And not because it's the best written, although I do think it's a well-written book, but not just because it's like this, oh my goodness, it's this amazing, well-written story. It's a good one, but it's just there's something about this book because it really does talk about a girl who believes that they're a woman, who her whole life has believed that there were dragons, and yeah, they are just myth in her world, in the world of this, they are just myth. They're talked about as we talked about with us in story and that type of thing. And then she actually ends up meeting a dragon for the first time, and she always hears that call. That's the song in silence of believing that there's something more. And it's just, it so speaks to, you know, me growing up, because I was was one of those kids who, we didn't have a TV. My TV broke when I was quite young. We had a little black and white, and it broke, and my parents decided it wasn't enough worth it at the time to get it fixed. And I didn't have a TV again until I was married. And that's not something there's a lot of things that I might regret about when later into more religious issues, but in terms of the television not being there, that's not something I will ever regret, because I never missed it, and I lived at the library and engulfed books, and that is only a good thing in my opinion. So, Song and Silence, love it. Robin McKinley, all of her books, her Deerskin, while it's difficult topic matter, is absolutely stunning. She's an amazing writer. And Sunshine, which is actually about vampires, and Neil Gaiman, one of my other favorite authors, labels this as pretty much perfect, and I have to agree with that. What else do we have? This was one of the first series, again, as an adult, around the same time I was reading Dennis McKiernan and Catherine Kerr. The first one is Strands of Starlight, and this is Maze of Moonlight by Gail Baudino. This is an amazing series. It really does deal with some deep religious issues, but fantastic, fantastic. Anything by Patricia McKillop. Anything by Patricia McKillop. This one is Song of the Basilisk, but truly you can pick up any one of her many books and they are like poetry in book form. They're so lyrical and so gorgeous and so stunning. Yes, you can read any of those. And then Terry Brooks, again, just because this was one of the first series along with Dennis McKiernan's, and this is not the first in the series. The first one, I believe, is Sword of Shannara, and there have been different, this has turned into a huge number of books and different trilogies and different time periods in the world. But he's fantastic. And I don't actually, because I was trying to get the older ones that really had gotten me sucked into the fantasy world a lot more. But because I have tons of books, so I could only fit so much on the little table, and I just wanted to kind of get those. But I just wanted to point all of this out because that's going to lead up as to why I was so excited about this particular deck of cards. I don't know why I grabbed this again, just because, again, this is one of those ones I've read, you know, if you're not feeling good or if your brain is just fried, like you have those books that you go back to just to read and you've read it so many times. Sunshine is like that by Robin McKinley. I listen to that actually on audio a lot just to go to sleep. And Song of the Silence. Again, it's not because if you want to talk like actual, oh my gosh, amazing writing, then you are looking at like Patricia McKillop, you know, she's just a stunning writer. There's many of them that are absolutely stunning writers, and I'm not saying anything wrong with her writing. I love this book, but it really isn't for me about that. It's just that feeling of longing for something more, for that magical, for seeing the elves out of the corner of your eye. Charles DeLint, he should be in here. He's another one that's like this, that just kind of plays with that sense of wanting there to be something more, wanting there to be dragons. There be dragons. So anyways, that leads us to this particular package. And again, the reason why I'm excited about this is because I've not seen very many of these cards. And whether or not it's going to end up working in terms of reading, I don't know. This was just a whim one. So that's why I thought I would share it. So we should rip it open. And there's also actually things about this deck that I know that I'm not going to like, but I got it anyways. Oh, that probably just revealed it. Oh. Okay, so here we have, probably glaring in the view piece, this is the Universal Fantasy Tarot by Paolo Martinello. And I think this is Lo Scarabeo. Yes, this is a Lo Scarabeo deck. And this is, I didn't even know this existed. I'll just at least take the plastic off so it won't glare so bad. This is actually, I have another Lo Scarabeo deck. But I have none that are like this that people complain about with the multiple languages on it, which is probably going to drive me nuts. I think it's still going to be shiny. This Two of Swords is absolutely stunning. Oh, stunning, stunning. So this says, a voyage on the edge of time to discover the secrets hidden in the folds of myth. A visionary world full of energy, populated by heroes and magical creatures. And then it has it in a different language on this side. I'm so excited about this. I can't even tell you. Now, I did research it enough to know. So here we again have a standard box. It's, you know, nothing amazing other than the picture on the front is stunning. We have our typical little white book that is going to be in multiple different languages, so it's even more worthless than most. So let's see. Yes, we have about 14 pages, and that's counting this, which isn't really a page. So, but here we do have the reason why I was so excited about this, because this is about fantasy literature. So fantasy fiction is sort of the idea behind this. So fantasy is one of the many narrative genres consisting of adventure stories and settings that, while they contain elements of our Middle Ages, are actually outside of time in a dimension that is extraneous to history. This fictional world is dominated by magic and populated by extraordinary characters and creatures, dragons, witches, invincible knights, demons, and gods. And then it goes on to give a history of fantasy fiction, and we have, you know, just a very, we're talking about a sentence that's for the major archon. Yes, about a sentence for each. And I, from what I have seen in some reviews, sometimes even the sentences that are there make absolutely no sense to the actual card, and given that some of them don't stick with the Rider-Waite-Smith, that's kind of problematic, but that's just going to be one of those decks, I think, that you kind of wing it. So, I'm also a huge gamer. I think I've said that before when I was talking about some of these bracers, but I've also been a gamer since I was 19, 20. My kids were raised sitting and watching me gaming with Legends of Zelda and Final Fantasy, and later my son and I were World of Warcraft addicts, and I still play all kinds of Tomb Raider. Oh, yeah, I'm a video game fanatic, all mostly set in this fantasy world, so that's why the quite geeky excitement, because it combines literature and gaming and all that wonderful fantasy stuff. The backing is reversible. I believe this is actually the Wheel of Fortune card that is like kaleidoscoped out, if I remember. I'm pretty sure that's what this is. So we have that in the backing. It is reversible. Cardstock is, you know, is fine with me. It's not great. It wasn't very expensive. It's what I certainly expected. It's going to shuffle great. I think they're kind of narrow. They're tall and narrow. I should get another card to compare it to. But I'm too excited to see these. So I have not seen these, very many of these. I've seen some of them. So as you can see, we have a couple things going on, and you know me and borders. We have a thin white border, which isn't, you know, it's not big. But then we also have a black, internal black border, where we have the various names of it in the different languages, which I have to say, of some that I've seen from Los Garabeo, this is better than some. I would be inclined to completely trim these. However, because at least not, I wouldn't do it immediately, because I don't think they would always be recognizable as to what they were. And I can't do my typical cut everything but this off, because it's at the top, and I don't know that I would like that. I don't know what I'm going to do about that. For right now, I'm just going to leave them alone. But here we have the Fool card. And again, this is all, you have to think fantasy literature. This is all tapping into fantasy literature. So we have the Fool, the Magician. I love this kind of stone. I've seen the first few of these. He is manifesting. You think about the Magician as the manifestation, and he is doing some serious manifestation. Here we have the High Priestess. Quite interesting. Oh, look at that. And they do say, some that I've read says that sometimes kind of skirts between science fiction, a little bit more sort of a fantastical mix of some of it's kind of a mix of like fantasy and science fiction, a little steampunky. Like, you do have a lot that's going on, because look at that headdress. Craziness. Here we have the Emperor. And this is so not in general my style, but again, because some of the cards, and when we get to them, I guess I'll say there's some that jumped out that was just Whoa, I was just blown away from it. And again, I don't know if I am I gonna like this to work with. I don't. That's beautiful. Look at the lover. Look at the lover's card. Lots of flowing energy I've seen just in the cards so far, but that's actually a beautiful. The chariot. Many winged horses. I guess this is the chariot that they're having to try to pull. I'm kind of feeling sorry for those winged horses. Strength. Look at that with the dragon. The hermit up away from the rest of the world. Like I said, there's a lot of flowing in the cloth. Oh, that's quite interesting. Yes, here's the wheel. Yeah, this is very mechanic-y. Makes me think also of like Stargate or something like that. Oh, justice. I did see this card. I think this is stunning. So, eight is strength, and justice is 11 in this deck. The hanged man. Beautiful. Apologize for the road noise. It's quite warm. And my air conditioning is also acting up. Everything's acting up. Here we have death. This one, I'm not as, you know, I have issues with many death cards. But it's kind of standard, more to Rider-Waite-Smith. Here we have temperance. Oh, the devil is quite creepy. Diable, even just seeing that up in the corner. Yeah, again, I also, you know me and the devil card. The devil's one of my favorite cards, but for me it's about a lot of different things besides the devil himself, but he is quite Diablo looking. The tower, that's actually quite beautiful. The stars. This is quite interesting. This kind of reminds me of Stargate too, the moon, because we just have sort of have these animal either, you know, I can see their faces under it, so they're kind of wearing these very shaman, but oh, look at the moon. Yeah, it definitely, for me, this one feels very much like Stargate. And yes, I love Stargate. Both the movie in all its cheesy glory and the television show in all its cheesy gory and all its cheesy glory. The sun. Sometimes they look almost like stained glass. This is not quite my favorite, but I didn't like a couple of the others. I don't, this is not one I'm going to say that I will love every single card, but I just couldn't resist because the fantasy world is just, that's beautiful actually. The fantasy genre, both in gaming and in literature, and in the way that I write much of my short stories and novels, things that I write is to do in the fantasy, not high fantasy, but still in the fantasy. And so I just, when I saw this, I could not. Okay, so actually, yeah. So now we're getting into the cups, which are the chalices. I have seen this one. I thought that was really pretty. It looks like a storybook. 'Cause he looks like he's looking into a mirror. Like they look like they're looking at each other through a mirror, but they're not actually in person and seeing each other. Right? There's some interesting dynamics going on there. Look at the Three of Cups. That is some interesting energy for the Three of Cups. Very much, even the coloration and stuff, you're getting more like the three fates or something like that. And here we've got almost like a wizard or something up here calling this up. Definitely different. I'm just out of curiosity. Let's just see what the book says about the Three of Cups. Because I have heard chalices. The great romantic and artistic passions must be ruled by reason and advice of those who share our destinies. See, I don't, yeah, I don't really see that. All right, again, this I absolutely love. Look at the dryad. How beautiful is that? Four of Chalices. And we do have the Four Cups here. I don't know that, yeah, I guess maybe these are, do show more of the actual, so that you do have an awareness of what the card is, maybe in the pictures more than I thought that there was. I do like this. I love this one. Yeah, they're up here. The Six of Chalices. Look at that. Look at that wonderful creature. Ah. Oh. I don't know what they're doing with one of this cup. They look like they're like gathering food and plants and stuff to eat maybe with it. I don't know. I love it. Seven of Chalices all up in there. So actually I might be able to trim this down. Eight of Chalices. Look, you have the, is this a goose, like a little goose? I don't know, it's like a bird here. Eight of Chalices is a little, like a Thumbelina, male Thumbelina up there. Or it's, you think of like Jack, he's up there with the ogres and he's flying off with a goose. I don't, that's kind of what the feeling I get. See, I'm just so curious. Eight. We must learn to govern our feelings to the utmost and leave those we have loved and fought for free to go. Ah, so I guess he's letting him go. Maybe this was like he had raised this little guy, just like the old lady that had raised Thumbelina. And at some point it's time he's just letting him go free. Aww. Nine of Chalices. Now this like candles are kind of using it in the candles. I mean, there's just so many, you literally could use this for like kind of jumping off of to write short stories, I think. Here we have the Ten of Chalices. See, then this is kind of feels quite traditional. I have other cards where we've got all of the cups in an archway like that. I hope you can see these. The Knave of Chalices with his fish riding creature thing, love, and he's holding a cup. So this actually, I could actually trim this down. Oh, look. Knight of Chalices is a centaur. Ooh, the Queen of Chalices. She's quite regal, isn't she? The King of Chalices. I love this water. She doesn't really have as much water energy going on, but he certainly does. And this kind of eel water snake in here, like Neptune's thing right there. Mm-hmm. Oh, see, now look at that. I'm a sucker for airboats. And this has a very steampunk feel to it. Yeah, I'm definitely a sucker for air flying dirigibles and such. I love that. Plus it's interesting because it's the pentacles, which is kind of very rooted in the ground, but we have them up in the air. Here we have the Two of Pentacles. Again, this is quite interesting. I do think this is a beautiful card, and I did see this. There's such a sense of movement in this flag, person who's moving the flags around, which has much more of an air feel to it, which I think is quite interesting. The Three of Pentacles. See, we got a little more of the steampunk, and I love this. Look at, she's looking through there. Mm. Four of Pentacles. She's like some futuristic, although then you have like medieval troubadours or musicians in the background, but then she almost looks like a futuristic person who is playing some kind of a discus game. Definitely a mix, a blend of science fiction and fantasy, I feel. Five of Pentacles. Look at how he's kind of standing there guarding sort of the gateway into the city, sort of blocking them out. Quite interesting. Here we have the Six of Pentacles, kind of hanging up in the trees. He's giving money over to the maidens. Seven of Pentacles. He The Eight of Pentacles. Look at that. It's quite interesting. We have almost like a dwarf here with his mining hammer. I don't know if he's created this or if he's, yeah, he's kind of standing back and looking at what he's created, or he's going to climb up there and try to get the gems out of there. I don't know. Nine of Pentacles. Quite interesting, because again, now here we have a mermaid, beautiful mermaid and peacocks. So that's quite interesting. And then the Ten of Pentacles, the group. Love that. See, that reminds me of sort of the party. We even with the little one here, and we've got the halfling here. Oh, yeah. Here we have the Knave of Pentacles. Cool. So obviously we have knaves instead of pages. Then we have I love the Knight of Pentacles. Look at, he's riding on a squirrel. Either a giant squirrel and a little guy, or a normal guy, or a little guy and a regular squirrel, which I would say yes, because look at the flowers. Ah, look at that. Love it. Queen of Pentacles. The queens are definitely very regal looking, as are the kings. King of Pentacles. I love this. This is such a strange card. This is the Ace of Wands, but I love it. Look at this giant wand. It's the head of this very gentle looking creature. We have people just sitting there at the fire, and he's just grazing on some grass, but just that powerful head and neck muscles to hold that up. The Two of Wands with a map, it looks like. It's interesting. Another airship. I saw this Three of Wands. This is one of the ones I saw. And again, I'm a sucker for an airship. I'm not saying that this didn't work for the Three of Wands, but he's out. He's gazing off into the distance. I don't know. I think it works. Four of Wands. Like they're playing a game of some sort. Definitely celebratory. Something going on, like a Quidditch match. Five of Wands. Quite interesting. Because these are their long beaks. Because here's their little eyes. And the butterfly. Six of Wands. Somebody's sitting in there with their head inside there. What's up with that? Seven of Wands. I love this card. Eight of Wands. I definitely saw this. Stunning. The Nine of Wands. Playing. He's like what is that called? He's like Puck. Totally blanking. He's like Puck, and he's got this amazing, interesting flute type instrument. This one is strange for me, and this one did get brought up in a couple reviews. This is the Ten of Wands, and so we have all the wands around here. This painter is obviously painting this woman here. But you don't get any kind of, obviously, heaviness, because it doesn't look like that's weighing him down at all. Let's just see what it says here. The ability to focus on the results, ignoring all distracting thoughts, is a skill shared by artists and warriors. Well, that works with what's in the book. It doesn't work with the traditional Ten of Wands, but I don't think that this deck is really meant to be read traditionally. Here we have the Knave of Wands. The Knight, oh, that's stunning. Definitely a lot, there's quite a few cards that have a stained glass feel to them. And she's beautiful, Queen of Wands. I did see this one. Look at how beautiful that is. Vibrant, vibrant, rich colors. King of Wands. Ace of Swords. So now we're moving to my favorite suit. We'll see what they did with it. I don't think I've seen too many swords, but that's beautiful. Well, yes, and this one, because that was one of the ones that made me want to have this deck. I'm definitely thinking I might just totally trim this down because, they do have the stuff in it that you need to know. Three of Swords is quite interesting. Three different swords, this kind of house in the distance, in the woods, in this kind of river of blood. Oof. Yes. Definitely have been to places like this in World of Warcraft. Four of Swords, that's beautiful. Yeah, I'm definitely loving the swords. This is strange. Five of Swords. He's almost like his armor is the city. Look at that. He's like a transformer with a city. He's like rooted into the ground. That's what it is. He's like the city has built up around this being, this giant being who is going to protect the city. That's interesting. I actually quite like that. What does it say? If the price of victory is too high, it may be wiser to choose honorable defeat. See, now there, I would say has absolutely nothing to do with this card. It doesn't look like he's being defeated. He's standing strong. The city has actually built itself up around him, and like he's the guardian of this place. Stunning. I think that's co really cool. I mean, I think you can do a lot with that in a reading. I definitely wouldn't read it as a traditional Five of Swords, probably, or as what they said. Six of Swords. I really like this. This is actually, there are some that are quite similar if you let go of the fantasy aspects that are quite similar to the Rider-Waite Smith, but then many that aren't. Seven of Swords, going off to the mountain with the dragons flying all around it with his crazy sword. Actually, one of the games that I've played in the past is League of Legends, and there's a character that you play that has a pretty cool swords like that. Here we have the Eight of Swords. I think this is awesome. Look at this creature with his sword legs surrounding her. Again, if you look at this card past the fantasy, it's quite traditional to the Eight of Swords, but then just with this fantasy creature from another world. Oh, look. Look at that. Well, that's missing the number, but that's the Nine of Swords. And look at that, though. She looks so anxious. Oh, that is wonderful. I actually think that's quite wonderful. I wonder if it keeps, let's see what it says. I'm just so excited. I'm sorry because I know this is so rambly. Ooh, like shadows, the demons inside us always seem larger and more threatening than they really are. Because, it's that shadow sense. Everything looks bigger when you're worried about it and you placed all this emphasis and weight onto it and it just gets bigger and bigger and just looms over the top of us. That's awesome. I have to say, I'm absolutely loving the sword suit. Then we have the Ten of Swords, which is kind of sad, actually. I'm generally on the side of the dragons, I'm not gonna lie. And it looks like they have slain this dragon. They've slain the dragon. Let's see. Even when all appears to be lost, we must remember that everything comes to an end and no enemy is invincible. Oh, so that's pretty awesome. The Knave of Swords. I love this purpley tones that I've seen in a couple of the swords. The Knight of Swords actually looks to be a woman, which is wonderful. The Queen of Swords, and this one I did see, and people talked about how you look at the Queen of Cups. And then you look at, this could almost have gone with the Queen of Cups because it has such a water sense in her dress, but I think it's a beautiful Queen of Swords. And then we have the King of Swords. I love the sword suit. I'm not gonna lie. I love the sword suit. I also am now quite, this one is quite interesting, so different than I guess in energy to what I would say the Three of Cups, evokes. And then some are very similar. So a very fantastical, very, see, I love that one now that I read it. So sometimes looking at the booklet does help. Sometimes you're going to look at the booklet and say, no, I'm not going there. So it's quite a blend and rich jewel colors. Look at the Queen of Chalices. Let's just see. Yeah, I'm definitely thinking I might just cut these all down. Because I'm not fond of all the different languages. Although I do think of ones that I've seen. Of low scarabeer decks with the different languages that I've seen, this is fairly obtrusive compared to some of those. It shuffles wonderfully. Yes, I'm quite fond. That's why I don't mind thinner cards, because especially if it's a cheaper deck. If it's an expensive deck, then I don't, then I do want the better card stock. But for a deck that's not much money, I'd rather it wear down and over the years than to not be able to shuffle it the way that I want to be able to shuffle it. So I actually do like how these shuffle. They're thinner. They certainly, if I trimmed off the edges, obviously would be even thinner. I'm going to tell you that they smell a little funny. But I have had my air conditioning leaking all over the carpet, so it might be that. Nope, this smells really funny. This is gonna, I couldn't have been smelling it when I pulled the books out because this wasn't unwrapped. So yeah, this is gonna need some airing out, I'm gonna say. So let's just see what we get. Judgment. See, he has got a horn and he's sort of calling them up and they're rising out of the flowers. So we do get that sense of rebirth here. This actually, to me, works pretty standardly. Then we have the Four of Pentacles and the Lovers. It's beautiful. You know, something that I've been doing lately with, and I'm going to wrap this up because I know this is long and quite not put together, because this really was just, whoa, what's going on? This is a new, I'm just going to grab this deck. I've never seen it before. It, you know, something different. I still can't tell you whether it's going to be readable. Like, will I use this to read for other people? I'm not sure about that. I'm really not. But I think it could be with getting used to it. But one thing I've been doing with cards, I kind of have taken this from Lenormand. Because, you know, when you read Lenormand cards, you're not digging quite, deep. You're kind of looking at it in terms of sentences. So three cards in a Lenormand is going to kind of tell you a sentence. And so I've been sitting with, a lot of times when I get my new decks, I literally kind of go through the whole deck in groups of threes. So then I kind of look at that and I'm like seeing what this particularly says to me, and I kind of real quick, just whatever grabs it. And then I grab up the next three that come up and I'm like, okay, what is that telling me? And again, I'm not really, it's almost a little bit like free writing. In that I'm not pausing to really censor myself or to really think, why does that say that to me? Why doesn't it say that to me? Is that traditional? Is it not traditional? I'm just going with whatever comes and quickly, and then just moving on to the next three, just like this. I've done this with the last few decks, and it really has been an exercise that has helped me to get to know the particular deck and kind of get into the energy about it without getting too over the, because that's one of my problems sometimes, is I get, because I am a researcher at heart, because I am somebody who has written a lot academically, who also writes just in terms of fiction, that sometimes I can get bound into trying to get just the right things down or think just the right things in the deepest meaning, whereas sometimes I think when I strip that away from myself and go more into a Lenormand or free writing aspect, it really starts to click things for me. So I just thought I'd add that little thing in there, just because it has been really great for me in the last few decks. This is the Universal Fantasy Tarot by Lou Scarabeo. I don't know if it's Lou Scarabeo, and the artwork is by Paolo Martinello. I think I could read with this. I can't imagine doing a really large deck with it, or a large spread with it, although I think you probably could. I can see three cards with it, certainly. I don't know, but, so there you go. This is the, and then it's also a tip on how you might want to go about getting to know a new deck. So I will check back with you and let you know. Let me know what you think about this. It is.